Searchlights, Codeline, Class 1 Railroad, 2021? Yes, you heard me right. There are still searchlights standing on this CSX line as of the time of this recording. For some strange reason, CSX was allowed to keep searchlights active on this line despite the mandate for PTC. However, insider sources tell me that the days that these searchlights are numbered. The line from Grand Rapids out to Lake Odessa was still running on ATCS, and at the time of this writing, has now been cut over to fiber and satellite, with the west end of Elmdale going down on September 30th, 2021, being the last control line that was running on ATCS. This seems to confirm the rumors that CSX is getting ready to modernize the line, taking the signals with the project. While the line from Lake Odessa to Plymouth still runs on Codeline logic, and the system is showing its age, all the searchlights you see here were set up when the Chesapeake and Ohio owned the line. As far as I know, only the signals at Enzel Yard in Lansing, Michigan, show the color position light layout that the CNO used. There are some vaders scattered around the line, but these were replaced when needed. Long gone are the heydays of this line. There are only four trains that run along this line now. D705/D706 from Grand Rapids to Plymouth, Michigan and back, D707 from Lansing, Michigan to Grand Rapids, and D708 from Lansing to Howell. There is a grain train, V097, that takes the cars from Enzel Yard and shoves them into the ADM plant in Grand Ledge. D705 and D706 used to be Q trains. Unfortunately, with precision scheduled railroading, CSX looked to cut costs where they could, and since local crews are paid less than Q trains, they were demoted. Right now, we are watching D708 shuffle cars around Enzel Yard, waiting to head out east for the various stops this train potentially has. This railroad crossing has the experimental plastic lights that GRS was tinkering with as a cheaper option than traditional all-metal lights. While being much lighter and easier to install, there were no metal components to the lights at all, minus the bulb, its sockets, and the wiring, which means over time, the hinges holding the lenses in would often crack and break. Brittle plastic as they age plagued these lights, and they were discontinued shortly after manufacture. With the train parked, built, and ready to run, all that's stopping this train from proceeding is a red signal. D708 phones the dispatcher to let them know that they're all set and proceed to their first stop. The old naming from the Conrail days is still valid, as the train waits to enter CP North Lansing. Our first catch of this train is in Okemos at milepost 77.6, where this train goes by us at a track speed of 40 miles per hour. As this train passes by, we can watch the intermediate signal upgrade as the train unoccupies the blocks ahead. As long as the next two intermediate signals are red, this one will remain red. When the train clears the next block ahead, it will upgrade to approach, and then once the train unoccupies the block after the next, it will upgrade to clear. Intermediate signals are a very easy way to tell if trains are in the area. However, you have to know the area to figure out the default indication. A signal can default to clear if no control points are ahead. One can default to approach if a control point is ahead, since the next signal would be red if nothing is cleared through the control point. Or on some railroads, an advance approach. Our next stop will be in Williamston. This train has an approach signal here since they will be working the ADM plant in Weberville. However, the dispatcher must give special instructions to the train before they can occupy the main to service the plant. The approach signal is given so that they can stop at the next control point, get their instructions, and proceed onto the main. On the next scene, I did capture a train with a signal and better lighting. However, they didn't have a stop in Weberville that day, so they were given a clear signal. Weberville, we catch up with D708 working the ADM Weberville plant. Unfortunately, I can't really get any good shots of them switching the plants around without committing any trespassing, so I can only grab the shot of them pulling out of the facility. The Weberville facility specializes in producing a broad range of plant nutrients, both in liquid and dry form. The plant is capable of producing custom formulas to their customers' specifications. Before the train can proceed forward, they need to unoccupy the crossing and clear the manual switch before the dispatcher can allow the train to proceed east to their next stop in Fowlerville. I had decided to leave in this clip of the railroad crossing since it has those plastic GRS lights on them. You can see where visibility would be a problem with these lights. As the angle you're looking at them changes, it pretty much makes it so you can only see them flashing if you look directly straight on at them. In Fowlerville, we catch D708 after they finish working Rytec. Rytec is responsible for manufacturing various polypropylene compounds, engineered resins, and other additives. The plant here specifically creates materials used in automotive interiors. Since there's no formal signal between Rytec and here in Fowlerville, the train must proceed at 3 miles per hour until they pass the signal. I had tried to get some footage of D708 passing Howell into the GLC interchange. However, the only way I could get footage was to be too close to the tracks to the point where the camera would have been hit by the train. I decided to get some scene shots for the sake of preserving the shot with the searchlights before heading to the GLC interchange. At the GLC interchange, we come up on more searchlights with smaller targets. The signal that protects the siding going onto the main is approach lit, so it will only light up if the train enters the occupancy block. This signal will display a slow clear to let the train run through the siding so that they can make a runaround move in order to drop off cars. The crew wastes no time heading back west. For this day, they're done and can head back west. However, we're not quite ready to head back west. On a different day, we caught D-708 going to Brighton before turning around to head back west. On this day, D-708 was left with cars that needed to be parked in Endel Yard to be eventually sent to Grand Rapids, Wyoming Yard, and then finally to the Q-327 Chicago-bound train. Due to the length of this train, it performed a runaround move in Brighton and then head back west. For once, I was able to catch these guys working on the weekend. D-705, that is. D-705 and D-706 have a heavy reputation for working during the night, which made it hard to catch any shots from Plymouth to Brighton and from Lansing to Lake Odessa. They sometimes work during the day, but it always conflicted with my schedule. But thanks to some intel, I got some heads up that D-705 was working that day, so I decided to catch them at the originating spot so that I could properly track these guys. In addition, it allowed me to railfan Plymouth for a little bit before I started chasing these guys. couple hours after arriving at Plymouth, I caught D738, a daily turn, except for Sunday, going between Livonia and Plymouth. The last two locomotives will be on our D705 today, a GP38-3, an AC44CW, and an SD70 Mac, something that is coming harder and harder to find on CSX lately, and this guy will lead our D705 all the way to Grand Rapids. The limestone cars on this train will appear on D705. They're destined for Enzel Yard, where they will be transported onto a Chicago-bound train in Grand Rapids' Wyoming Yard. It is unclear where the cargo is coming from and where it will wind up. These could have come from one of the many limestone mines in Ohio. Coming out of Plymouth, Michigan, 15 minutes after getting their signal, we DC705 split the signals here. I was hoping to be able to catch this intermediate upgrading to a clear after the train had passed. However, the signal never changed because the control point ahead of it was displaying a stop indication. Thank you. Arriving in South Lyon, the signal is set to an approach indication. This was the first day I started rail fanning the sub, and it was dumb luck that I saw this approach signal. I had only intended to take pictures of the signals, so this was a very welcoming sign. The train hadn't been cleared out of Plymouth completely, so the dispatcher didn't line this train all the way to Lansing quite yet. After the dispatcher clears the train through Plymouth, our D705 gets a clear signal here in South Lyon and has a straight shot to Enzel Yard in Lansing. There's no work for them in Enzel Yard, so once they get to Lansing, this train on this day will get cleared to Grand Rapids, Michigan. Picking back up from our eastbound chase of D-708, we catch them finish with their runaround move and watch them begin to head back west to Ensel Yard. To get you back up to speed, after these guys finish their stop in Weberville, they had cars that needed to be sent back to Grand Rapids. With the siding at Howell being too short, they opted to do their runaround move in Brighton to have more space than they needed, which in this case was very much preferred. Catching a different D-708 on a different day, we watched them pick up cars from the GLC interchange after they finished dropping some off. Unfortunately, the crew and dispatcher had a bit of a lapse of judgment. You hear the crossing going off, right? The signal systems here are old, and the crossing relies on the CTC logic to trigger the gates. If the signal is displaying stop, and the train is on the approach block, the crossing does not activate, since the system is wired to think that there's yard work going on. But if either signal shows anything but stop, and the train has stepped on the approach block, the crossing signals activate. For some reason, the dispatcher could not rescind the signal, which meant the town of Howell was deadlocked for 40 minutes while they waited for the crew to resolve brake issues going on with the train. After someone called in the crossing, the crew got quite the mouthful from the dispatcher that they knew about this problem, and they shouldn't have told the dispatcher to give them the early signal. However, the dispatcher also knew about this problem, had made a note about it earlier, and the crew reminded them of this. Oh well, I guess these things happen, but still, a bit of a troublesome issue.
Yes, sir, he just gave me a false false activation at Dearborn. Got him over. Yeah, we had a problem with the EOD conductor walking back. He's on his way back up. When we're ready to go, we'll give you a call.
All right, that'll be fine. Just give me a call. I go by Dearborn Street Cross without giving me a call.
We won't move until we talk to you, over.
All right, thank you. CSX, TRN, dispatch, Jack, hello.
708 up.
All for it, because if you give us the signal, the gates come down. And this is what we end up having to do, is do a EC1 on this.
You know, I was aware of that. I thought you all had been in there long enough, and I figured you was ready. But I was aware of that, but next time we'll just wait there.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah, so yeah, but if we're at EJ Sears on the copy, and then CH54.0, and well, you got the CSXT 4037.
Circle line 16, false partial activation.
account.
Automatic grade crossing water device malfunction at Dearborn Street Road Crossing at milepost CH54.1 on all tracks. No on the flagger. Open.
Project EC1 number 83241. Today's date 5/19/21. CH54.0 to the D70819. CSX T4037 EJ Sears on the copy. Circle line 6B. False partial activation. Account automatic grade crossing warning device malfunction at Dearborn Street Road Crossing at milepost CH54.1 on all tracks and no on the plane.
That's Greg, repeat of EC1, number 83241, copy by EJ Sears on the CSX T4037. Short OK and effect at 1726, 1726, WJWO.
Repeat it correctly, 1726, WJW, thank you.
That is correct, though.
At East Lansing, this is the second to last signal before the Trowbridge Diamond in Lansing. It is currently displaying an approach signal for a D708. This is because no one gets cleared through the diamond until they're close enough to justify the dispatcher clearing you through the diamond. This intersects with CN's Flint Subdivision, which directly parallels the East Lansing Amtrak station. Since CSX got close enough to the diamond first, it's given to them over CN, and their signal upgrades from an approach to a clear. Their only stop now is their terminating destination. Unexpected searchlights are the best searchlights. Admittedly, I did find this one on the map, on Google Maps, but I didn't think it was accessible. Already having a westbound shot at the crossing to the west, I decided to chance it after seeing this residential lot, and sure enough, the signal was visible without trespassing.
705.
Crossing over the deep end. I didn't get to see it, but the D705 that we caught coming out of Plymouth ripped off a knuckle and made an emergency stop. I didn't realize it happened until I saw a Facebook post after I went back to Lansing. I had to drive all the way back to Okemos, and by the time I did, they were already getting ready to leave.
Thank you.
Now this shot I got lucky with. There was no way I'd be able to catch this shot with the signal getting knocked down with a full train rushing by. I'd have to stand directly next to the train, which is not worth it at all. However, with D-708 being light power back to Lansing, I was able to capture this shot after the power passed. Too bad the camera lost focus right as the signal was knocked down. I managed to get ahead of D705 in downtown Lansing for a shot of downtown with the road straight to the Capitol building. It made for a really nice shot, getting the train crossing the road with the city in the backdrop. Thank you. I was hoping that I'd be able to catch these guys leaving the yard, but with it being 10:30 and the train not showing signs of departing soon, I decided to head home since I still had an hour-long drive ahead of me. On a later day, I caught D708 finishing their duties. They shuffled the cars they hauled back into the yard before sending the power into the bowels of the yards. These signals are interesting because while they look new, they still show the CNO indications, with the red on the top light on the top head of the signal. I'm not sure what the reasoning was behind this, as it seems it would cause quite the confusion, especially since the middle head has the red on the bottom light. Kinda weird. After that day, we find D705 working the yard before heading off to Grand Rapids. We'll get to see the train come in and out of the yard constantly, making good use of this signal west of the yard. And here we see a close-up of some 90s rail marking. They're all generally read the same. The 122 represents the weight of the rail in pounds per yard. VT means that the rail is vacuum treated, meaning that most of the dissolved gases are removed from the rail, making it much stronger. The M blended in with the H is the company that rolled this piece of rail. I can't seem to look up the company at this time. However, if anyone knows, please do let me know. 1999 is the year that the rail was rolled, and the hash marks by it represent the month that the rail was rolled. Since there's 10 hash marks, this means that the rail was rolled in October. I'm not sure what the single C and what the single CB and single M represent. Again, if anyone has any insight to this, please let me know. Out of dumb luck, I managed to catch one of the local grain trains operating after a long day of chasing D-708. This is V-097, about ready to shove empty cars into the ADM plant behind us. The crew will first need to run their power around the train to the other end before they shove the cars into the plant.
Yeah, when I was a little kid, they had semaphores right there.
Nice.
Watch your ears.
Well, when you have to.
Thank you.
Almost 20 miles away is the next accessible searchlights in Sunfield that are approach lit. From what I've noticed on this line, is that once these lights light up, the train is virtually on top of you. Note the spire on top of the signal to the left. These spires were on the original Pure Marquette signals, along with their in-base signal cabinet. These once had been semaphores installed before the CNO took over the Pure Marquette. To the best of my knowledge, this is the only one on this line that's like this, so it's definitely special, and it was a very good find.
Exactly as I predicted.
So I thought this was interesting. At Clarksville is a different sounding defect detector with a different voice. This is a Southern Technologies, not related to the Southern Railroad, Smart Scan NG2 defect detector. I was surprised to learn it's a relatively new detector with the old sounding voice. Most of the CSX now uses Devtronic CMA02 detectors with the enthusiastic voice. On a bit of a lucky day while heading to a coin show, I caught D705 on one of their normal nighttime runs arriving back in Grand Rapids. I have always wanted to get a shot of them crossing the CNO bridge over Patterson Avenue Southeast. For anyone that worries that this bridge is going away soon, the paint is well upkept, it's mostly made of solid steel, so there's no reason to tear it out. And Chessie the cat and her stripes are welded onto the sides of the bridge. It would be way too much effort to remove the old logo, so it stays. This is the last stop before we catch them going to Wyoming Yard. This bridge is going over a busy 28th Street and is as old as the Pier Marquette, and it really does show. However, getting to catch a train here is something I've been meaning to do for a very long time. The car is passing by under with a train going over it seems really appealing to me for some reason.
someone down to the fire road.
Okay. Coming down to the fire road.